actually break apart without, because today we can see that the world hegemon, which is the United States, can do essentially whatever they want, but we are trying to make it so that it is much harder for them to do what they want, especially in an economical sense, because they cannot, they do not have the same amount of leverage with these regions as they would normally do. So, yes.
Why is it necessarily bad that the USA is putting money into these poor nations that need that money?
Well, you see that there are a few layers of this. First of all, we see that this, the United States is not doing this for their for altruism's sake. They are doing it to extract as much resources as possible. And by while doing that, they actually hurt the region quite a bit. They poison the water and completely destroy the environment. And on top of that, we see that the whole pressure of the pressure coming from the United States and stuff actually corners these small regions into, you know, it causes them to essentially hurt a lot. On top of that, we see that actually free trade, you talked about, oh, free trade agreements will never be, you know, exploitative, it will be perfectly fine because they're free. Well, just because there's the word free in the name of the agreement does not mean it's actually very just or very good. Generally, we see that these free trade agreements are used as a bludgeon to exploit people and also extract concessions from countries, especially in the political sense. On top of that, we see that you talk about how free trade will actually improve this situation, but we don't actually see that in our in status quo. The difference between rich countries and the poor countries are actually getting larger, and the damages are not only for today; they are actually so bad that they will last for more for hundreds of years. Not only in terms of not only in terms of social sense, but also like environmental sense. On top of that, the second point under the benefits was conflict and which side would have less conflict. Now, you talked about how there is literally no interest to keep the peace, but we also see that the interest to actually go to war is much less in our system. Because one, the tensions aren't as high, the competition isn't as high, because there is no historical backing between these regions, this conflict. We do not have any case of past rivalry between France and Germany as we did for like 100 years and like 3-4 wars between them. And also, we talked about how it's logistically harder, in which you dismissed, we have planes. Well, I have to say, just because Hitler had tanks does not mean it's easy to invade Russia. We see geographical barriers are really hard to overcome, especially when these are oceans and really big spaces. Just because you have planes does not mean you could successfully overcome the China. Into China, you cannot, as the United States, it's impossible to actually launch a successful invasion, let alone actually maintain supply lines over such long distances against our China. And even if you could, we see that these two powers would actually not go to war because the tensions that exist there aren't as high as if they would, that would exist if these two countries were actually bordering each other. This way, we see that in terms of region, it actually would create much more cohesion. On top of that, you talked about how this development actually would spread, it actually would help it. Well, you talked about how Europe actually fixed the problems it has. Well, maybe Europe did, but you see, it's a completely different situation we have today. The reason being is, when Europe did it, they were the first, and now they have all the power, and the corporations there, and the countries there, actually, it's not in their best interest for these regions to develop, because, as you said, they want the cheap labor, they don't want anything else, and if the cheap labor gets more expensive, want their profits decrease, and that's exactly why they want them to keep these countries poor, and that's how they actually play with these free trade agreements, and how they actually kill the local businesses there and overpower them. You talk about how America and all these countries will actually protect other nations, which we see that is not really the case. We see that the hegemony America has is something it just uses as it will. It invades places in which if any other country gets invaded, it would be facing sanctions, and the United States isn't doing that. On top of that, we have the benefits to the region, and we see that The biggest benefit we provide is that how the local businesses will actually be able to compete against, be able to survive. Because now we have these big corporations and big companies which come in and completely break these businesses apart and overpower them. This actually causes much more poverty and actually causes a lot of social problems in these countries. Now you talked about how they won't have any money because you know these blocks are close from each other. Well, this is completely unrealistic because as long as there are people and goods being produced, there will be some economy, and we believe that this economy will be much more equitable and much more fair. And that is why the trade within the region would be enough to sustain this economy. And also you talked about exploitation, how it doesn't happen, and supply and demand is a really good thing. Well, we see that this actually supply and demand hurts the local business quite a bit, and it causes incredible amounts of unemployment as well. And you talk about you talk of foreign investment as if it's a perfect thing, but we see actually foreign investment is a form of neocolonialism because it kind of goes in and takes the resources and does not really care about anything else. And then you have mercury in the water and people getting cancer. And overall, we see this doesn't happen. You also made a point about human rights, which actually does not happen because it's actually undermined because we see nationalists and communists using this rhetoric to bolster their support. And that is why we believe, both regionally and globally, we are above team opposition.
Thanks for your speech, and I think we'll have some proposition speaker.
In this debate only talks about how now magically the local businesses will appear and everybody will be happy and have money and the poor countries now will finally grow. But what were we telling you this entire debate? That is something that will not happen. And we were telling you that entire debate, and in my speech I will show you how exactly we win this debate and what exactly happened. So, firstly, I want to say something about how they frame themselves in this debate about how now every country will have everything they need. But what about gas? What about oil? How will they get that? How will now these countries that that are settled in the world and in some part that they don't have these essential things that countries need, how will they get that? That is something that the side of opposition never tells us and something that they never really explain. And they never really referred to our point about that now the countries and every country is now specialized for making one product. As we were even giving you examples of countries that are specialized for like cinema, that is something that we were telling you. And what they didn't understand and they never referred to is that those countries will no longer could sell that product to any other countries because now that region, that little trading block, will no longer need that amount of product. And now that amount of product will just stay somewhere in some factory. And what will happen in the end, that the factories will even fire some employees because they will no longer need that kind of big production because there will no longer be that amount of people, actually the countries who will buy those products. So let's go in further into the debate about how they always talked about these local businesses from their first speech, but they never really explained How will they get these local businesses going? How will those countries now suddenly will be having factories who will build some things that they didn't build before? How will those people who worked for generations and generations in cinnamon factory, how will they now suddenly will be working on some other things that are not cinnamon? Because that is not something that happens instantly. We can't just change people's minds and tell them, oh, for decades you were working in a factory cinnamon. Well, that no longer will do because we don't have that big of a market. And now we will fire half of you and you have to work something else. That is something that they never really explained us. How will these new factories will now be built, and who will work in those factories, and how will people know how to work? The next thing that we will keep fighting in this debate is that about this global peace and what exactly will happen. And what we were telling you is that if you make business with one country, if you make business with some country, that means that you don't, you won't attack it because you make profit out of making business with that country, and then you won't attack it. And that means that you won't attack some other country, and that means that we will not have a war. And everything they said about that is that, oh well, United States can't attack some countries that is so far away because it is so far away. But what they're telling you is that today United States has nuclear bombs, and it's pretty easy for you from the United States put a nuclear bomb somewhere in Asia and blow up entire the city or entire country because you no longer have a connection with that country in Asia because you don't make business with it. And if that country doesn't anymore give you some products, and if you don't have a profit out of that country, so you no longer have a connection with that country, and that is why you will maybe even attack that country because that country no longer gives you anything like gas or oil, and that is why that is how exactly in their world we will have multiple wars between a lot of countries and nations. Other thing they say that countries in the trading blocs will help each other, but they never really explain how will those countries and why will they why will they help each other? Why will they help each other's economy? They never talked about it. They only said that, oh, now we will have local businesses, and that is all that will happen. All they said is that rich countries don't have incentive to help poor. But what we talked about is that those countries now have factories there. Now buy those products from that poor countries. And now, today, in our world, will poor countries get money from the rich countries? And that is how they exactly, the poor countries will get something from the rich ones. And all they said is that, oh, the rich countries don't have initiative to help the poor. What about they never referred really to about how the products will get cheaper, how the products will get better? They never talked about it. They never really referred to that, and never really said about that. What we are telling you that in our case, all the countries basically around the world will now be able to buy those products, because they will be firstly cheaper, and that means that a lot of countries will be now able to buy it, and secondly, the product will be the best, because all the countries will be specialized for some product, and now they will have all the countries will have all the products and the best product. And in there about the point about the poisoning the water, they never really talked about it until their last speech. So I think that doesn't stand. And other thing that talked about. studies that how if the China's market or economy fails, that now in our case the entire world will be hurt by that. But what we are telling you is that if it happens in regional trade blocks, the entire bloc will be hurt by the falling of the market of one country. But in our case, if it happens, the other countries all around the world will try to help that country, because they will have initiative to help the countries that they make profit of it, because they work together, and other countries of the world will try to help that country. But in their case, one country will be failing at some market, and the entire region will be failing at that market, and no other region will try to help that region. So the entire region will basically, in their case, be hurt. And that is how exactly they lost this debate, because they haven't explained us how the war in our case will be worse, and what we tells you that in their case the war will happen, and the trading blocks will be hurt by other countries.
Thanks a lot for your speech, and I call now the opposition to reply, speakers from the bench for the opposition.
Sweatshops today, and to stop the Westerners trying to exploit them. Or we can be rational. We can look at the facts and we can see that through global trade, it's the only way for these poor nations, the nations which had before were in complete poverty, can have a way to develop, to move forward, and to finally progress and have a long-term benefit to the economy. We can see that in this speech, I'll try to analyze some basic things that both sides claim, and see why side of opposition truly wins the debate. So inside proposition, there is no trade between the trade blocs and only within. And this is terrible for these nations, completely terrible, because they have no way to move forward. Poor nations develop by selling their things to rich nations and getting and thereby taking capital, the money that these nations give them, to invest into their infrastructure, to invest further into their economy, and to further develop their resources. So there is no way on their side for these nations, these poor nations, to capitalize on their advantage, to capitalize on their position, their geography, and their resources have provided them. And this is basically telling them to take their ticket to development, to take their ticket to economic advancement, to take their ticket out of poverty and throw it into the fire. So, but what they have said is just that there will be less crisis. Of course there will be less crisis. If everyone is poor, it's not never a crisis. If they can never advance, they won't be hit by a crisis. If they are constantly left in a state of poverty, then truly have to live from, I don't know, farming and subsistence living. Of course the crisis won't affect them, because they won't have any money to be affected by the crisis. They also will not ever have any, they will never have their market to sell their products to. They're simply in their regions where they have all the same resources, where they have similar economic situations. What they have is too much supply, and because everyone has it already, too little demand. So they will never be able to fulfill this. They will never be able to sell to these people, and will have to settle for products that they do not have a disposition to, that they have not been making, for generations, and will have to, and will therefore have less product, will be less productive. They will have less of an advantage over other nations, and will not be able to compete with rich nations which can invest much more into infrastructure, but without obviously geographic and natural benefits. Also, on their nations, what will happen is war. What they will have is they will not be able, and not just any war, not just war between US and Iraq, which is just two nations fighting each other. What they will have is a regional trading box. They will have European Union versus, the former Soviet republics. What they will have is these giant trade blocks without any connection between them, with economies completely isolated from one another, having no incentive, no incentive not to fight each other. As a matter of fact, because they cannot trade, they will have an incentive to fight each other to get the resources that they do not have on their own local territory and to be able to provide what they can to their own citizens. And they will use planes and ships and missiles to transport these troops if it's far away, as we see in the modern world, which I do not understand why such proposition cannot simply grant. So, on our side, we have foreign investment. We have capital going to these nations. We give them an opportunity to develop. We give them an opportunity to rise from poverty, to rise from a situation which, for example, Europe was in hundreds of years ago, and to do it much quicker because they actually have foreign investment. They can use the competitive advantage, and they have a large market to sell to, and they can do it in peace because there will be no war. Thank you very much, and this is why we believe you should.
Ladies and gentlemen, today we came to side opposition with a problem. They say we have a problem, which is that these countries are so poor, they cannot depend on themselves, they are very dependent, and this creates very big risks. Nevertheless, they couldn't show us how this does not happen and will not happen, because in the status quo we have this problem. They didn't show us any solutions for this, and this is why they couldn't engage in this debate and they couldn't understand the aim of this debate today. So the thing is that they said, okay, so these countries they cannot buy products because they are not cheap. But what we told you is that they cannot buy products because they are poor. But if they earn, we told you that if they earn money in the first place, if those countries wasn't prohibited by monopolies in the first place, it would not matter if they could actually buy it even if it was expensive. So they could be self-dependent and okay with, and without any risk too. They told us that the exploitation came way too late or something. But the thing is that they kept thinking that America is this amazing power which just puts everything, like makes everything pink. It cares very much about human rights, and it doesn't leave that country after exploiting it. It's poisoning the waters and all. We told you that this cannot stand in long term. This only will end with the death of certain countries and with the unimaginable power of certain ones. And they told us so how are they gonna find gas? We're telling you. The thing is that it is very hard for them to buy gas right now too. In this case, they now at least have an incentive to find other sources, solar energy or something. But the thing is that what we told you is that today our risks were bigger than this. Our risks, they cannot buy it now anyways. Our risks were that risks were people not being able to eat cinnamon because they cannot buy benefited from all resources of the world. Nevertheless, our risks was a possible collapse of world order, a possible collapse of world economy. And there is this point of troops and etc. Okay, we know that you have troops, but we know that it is much easier to go in a country in a war which is bordering you. For example, if Africa was bordering U.S., U.S. will not be less likely to exploit Africa because Africa now that would have actually some resources even a little bit to fight America. Nevertheless, you just kept assuming that the logistics are endless in Africa. But what we told you is that of course Turkey will be less willing to get in a war with Syria because it is much easier for itself to get hurt. So overall, we see that side opposition in this case cannot assume that status quo, which is the free market actually, has no problems and is will stand in the very long term. But we told you again and again that it won't, because America, those one countries, only care about their they will be able to buy those expensive stuff because they will not be poor anymore. We are giving you a possible solution, and we're telling you that we're in the verge, we're in the end of like a possible crisis. And you could not prevent this risk anyhow. There was no point which was against the point of the possible corruption of the world, and there was no solution to the aim of us, to the problem we had in the first place. And this is why we believe that we probably won this debate.
Good job.